Drew Tube. Welcome to Hashtag Religion Week TV. I'm your host, Drew L. Murray, and here we sip a lot of tea with no shade, talking everything up the Yahweh. Enjoy the video. Tea, no shade. Hey, YouTube. Back again. Yeah, so anyway, you can't prophesy, you can't speak tongues, I mean to say, in front of the church at all, the Bible says, unless there's an interpreter there to interpret the tongues, because you got people confused with what's being said, they don't understand, and God wants everybody to be on the same page with understanding his word. So it says that a prophet is subject to a prophet. If you're going to speak in tongues, do it with another interpreter there. If not, don't do it at all. Did you hear that, church? Because y'all running around there speaking in tongues, nobody interpreting what you're saying. You're being disobedient to the word. And then we like to say everything is done decently and in orderly. That was said because people was running around speaking in tongues and everybody was speaking and nobody could understand, and there was two and three prophets doing it at one time, the Bible was explaining, and it said speak one at a time. You go, give your interpretation of it, let the next one go. That way there's no confusion. And then the Bible goes on to say, so everything is done decently and an orderly. And you like to take that scripture and apply it to your hustle in the church or whatever you got going on in the church. You want things done decently and in order so people don't find you out. Okay? But I'm gonna try to find it for you real quick here. Hold on. Hold on, YouTube. This is going to give you a little bit more here. Hold on. So, yeah. So, basically, pastors tell you, things got to be done decently and orderly. But that scripture is not talking about the hustle they have going on in the church, if that's the case. That scripture, and I'm trying to find it. Hallelujah! That's what I'm talking about, Holy Spirit. It's right here in 1 Corinthians 14 and 30. And 40. Okay, it's the last verse in chapter 14, 1 Corinthians. It says, let all things be done decently and in order. And you will allow the church and the pastor to run away with the scripture talking about you can't chew gum in school, you can't be late coming to church, or they're going to shut the doors. You can't wear jeans, you can't wear red lipstick, you can't wear braids. But you can eat and grow fat in church. You can do all this. You can't do anything else, but you can eat and grow fat in church, okay? No disrespect to nobody. But that's what the church is growing the church to do, is to grow in fatness and richness and all this sickness, but not the truth of the word of God, okay? It says, let all things be done decently and in order. But if you read the context prior to that, you can see it's not the way you establish your church rules. Although, I want my house to be running decently and orderly. So I set rules. I get that. Ain't no lawlessness here. I have more than you five people if that comes to my house at one time. You gotta have some order. Hold on, YouTube. Just trying to work it out with Facebook, and we're going to wrap it up. So, yeah, so Facebook. So, if you go back and read the context prior to that, in the book of 1 Corinthians 14, it's breaking down prophecy, prophets. It says right here in verse 27, if any man speak in an unknown tongue, let it be by two, or at the most by three, and that by course, and let one interpret. How many times do you see people in church speaking in tongues and nobody's there to interpret it? This is biblical Christians. This is biblical believers. This is what the Bible says. You say, oh, hallelujah, I'm obedient to God. And you're not. You're not. You're not. I speak in tongues. I did it once. I think I started coming on here in September of last year. And I may have did, oh, I don't know, just going into, but then you realize, like, people can't interpret this, Drew. This goes on to say, hear me out. It says, but if there be no interpreter, let him keep silent in the church and let him speak to himself and to God. Yeah, I didn't say this. Now, you go around and you tell every pastor, especially that T.D. Jakes, because this ain't allegedly, him and everybody else speaking in tongues out there. I'm just waiting for Facebook. I said this is going to be a half hour talk. Thank you so much, though. I appreciate it. Now, yes, you go out there and you tell every pastor, every preacher, everybody that's so close, shout-na-da-da-ba, sounding alike when everybody's supposed to have their own tongue and their own language. You go out there and you tell them, yes, Miss Drew said it's in 1 Corinthians 14, verse 28, but if there be no interpreter, let him keep silent in the church and let him speak to himself and to God. And then it goes on to talk about the prophets. Let the prophets speak two or three and let the other judge. So you, I heard an apostle said he's supposed to judge the prophet, but it says right here in the book in verse 30, if anything be revealed to another that sitteth by, let the first hold his peace. Meaning if there's two or three prophets around and they talking to the congregation, one get a prophecy, let the other one finish before you get up there, because it's bringing confusion to the church. And you wonder why the church is so confused. If I sit here and say, oh, shanda kara, ba, 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 ba. Do you understand what I said? I just confused you, right? But what does the church do? Oh, hallelujah. Oh, hallelujah. What the hell did I just say? That's it. They want you confused. Bible said don't be confused like that. You ask your pastor, anybody here to interpret that? I'm sorry. This is good to me, YouTube. Facebook keep going out over here. I think we've been doing this about 2 hours now. I got some good footage for today. So listen. You go to the pastor and say, hold up, wait a minute. Is anybody here to interpret what you just said? I'm sorry, but the Bible says let all things be done decently and in order, because if that says it up here in verse 28, 29, 30, it goes all the way down to tell you what prophets and prophecy is supposed to do. And then it ends up with let all things be done decently and in order. But we running around here, got all this decently in order. And the church is the most confused place I see right now. Ain't nothing. Or some churches, we not talking about all the churches. We talking about the bigger, wider church, the variety, the ministries, the big body churches out there. It's a lot of disorder. Ain't nothing decent about them because they so far from the word of God. Let me just go on with this because I see here at 2 o'clock we're going to wrap it up, okay? I told you, I make videos on YouTube, so if I talk for 2 hours, that's 4 videos right there, God. Guys, I'm not saying what's going to go viral. I'm not asking God to use me. That's all comes with the game. Everybody wants the video to go viral. I want the message, the word of God, to go viral. So as much as I talk, I can chop these videos up, and then I have more videos to post at the end of the day. Hold on, YouTube. So, like I was saying, Facebook, if the more I talk, I could go back and chop up a 2-hour talk. If I want to do 10-minute videos, well, if you understand YouTube, And to get your commercials or your ads in there, gotta be a little bit over 10 seconds for you to get your ads. I don't even have 30 views or whatever. I got one subscriber. So you have to have 10,000 views even to start earning money over there. So I have a long way to go. My thing is, if I talk, the longer I talk, I can chop these videos up and have more videos to put up, more information for people to look at instead of looking at a 2-hour video. You know, this is live right here. So if it stays up on my Facebook page, fine. But when I get it over to YouTube, I don't want to put up a 2-hour video. So that's what I'm trying my hand at. Again, like I said, I have my nursing agency I'm trying my hand at. I am an LPN, but I want to be my own boss. So I'm trying to work some contracts out for me to work as an independent contractor right now. Do I want to go out and do the work? Absolutely not, because I started this business so I could be an employer. But every great employer knows that they have to go out and do the work in order to raise some funds. Hold on, YouTube. Hold on. So, hold on. It's coming. So, I was saying Facebook. Every great employer knows that if you can't raise $8,000 for your general liability, your professional liability, your errors and omissions, your workman's comp and disability to hire your first employer, every good employer knows you have to go out there, sacrifice, do some work, raise the funds on your own. That's why I'm trying to do videos on YouTube. I'm doing surveys online. I downloaded feature points, because if you download them little video games and play them for like 2 minutes, you earn money in your PayPal account. So I'm doing what I have to do to raise the funds to go out there. I need $2,958 just so I could go work as an independent contractor. I'm not going to go apply for another agency because I'm an agency. I'm not going to go apply to the facility because as an independent contractor, I get contract more money than with the people that get paid at the facility. So, but I'm doing everything I can, no stone left unturned. I'll even do Uber rides locally, Schenectady, Troy, Hudson, if that's what it takes to raise the funds that I need so that I can get out there and change my life dramatically. But until then, I love doing YouTube videos. I love talking face to face now. And I love encouraging, exhorting, and comforting people with the word of God, with hope. And that's about the most love you can give anybody. Hold on, YouTube. Because I done started you back up again. I cut your video down. I restarted recording again. But I love this. Hold on 1 second. We're going to wrap it up. Okay. So that's about the most love you can give anybody, is to want to see their soul go to heaven, want to see them exhorted, encouraged, and comforted on a daily basis. That's about the most love you can. The Bible says, owe no man nothing but love. I don't owe you nothing but love. I owe you nothing but love, and my love is to give you this word of God, because he told me to feed my sheep. So let's finish going down with this. I've been wanting to do this because there's a lot of things in the Bible. The Bible say don't do that. We do. So did you get that about speaking in tongues? It says it right here in 1 Corinthians 14:27. It says, don't do it unless there's somebody there to interpret it. And it says it brings confusion. Verse 29 goes on and says, let the prophet speak 2 or 3 and let the others judge. I heard an apostle say he judged the prophets. That ain't what the Bible said. You mind your business. The apostle's supposed to start the church. The prophets is supposed to prophesy to the church. Stay in your lane. That's what's wrong with the church. Everybody want to do everything in the church. It's only a fivefold ministry. Remember, Christ is the head. You better start from the shoulder, torsos, the arms, and the legs. Pick your spot. I believe the apostle had the greater calling, so they bodied the body. Is the apostles, the prophet, the teachers, the pastors, and the evangelists. Which arm or leg are you? Because Christ is the head. which arm or leg are you? Hold on, YouTube. We're just gonna get through this real quick. Hold on. So, I say, we say the body of Christ. Okay, fivefold ministry. Christ is the head. Get out of his position, okay? He is the head. So, you got the torso and the arms. Apostles, the Bible said, they kind of got the vision and start the church. So, we'll give them the body because the church rests on the apostles. It did, at least in the Old Testament. Nowadays, you got preachers, teachers, non-believers, everybody starting the church. Just so they 503C. So they can become not-for-profit. Ain't got no God in them whatsoever. But nonetheless, apostles is the torso. So you got to figure, prophet, pastor, teacher, evangelist. Which arm or leg are you? It's only, you can't go, you can't get in the head. This is Christ. Everybody get out the head. The Bible says put on the mind of Christ. Not put Christ in your head or you in his head. It says put on the mind of Christ. But you can't be the head. You got to settle for being the torso. I give that to the apostles. And I said in one teaching that the prophets may come because they got the vision and the direction. They better teach the teachers something so the teachers could teach the pastors and the pastors could teach the evangelists. And then we get this thing rolling, like if we get the body of Christ walking like it's supposed to. Because right now, it's broke down. It's broke. It's broke down. It's limping. It's walking on its knees. Come on, Facebook. Don't do this. All right. We almost done. So let me just finish this. I love it. Hold on, YouTube. All right, so we're going to wrap it up. So, basically, God hates six things. Seven things is an abomination. And I just ran it over into what prophecy really is. Exhort, encourage, comfort. Prophets are subject to prophet. Real prophet know another real prophet. They don't need no other body, the apostle, teacher, pastor, none of that telling them. A real prophet of thus saith the Lord is subject. It says right here in verse 29, let the prophet speak two or three and let the other judge. It didn't say no other fit ministry fold, no other part of the body come judge nothing but the prophet, okay? And 30 says, if anything be revealed to another that sitteth by, let the first hold his peace. If you prophesying and I get something, I ain't supposed to overspeak you, tell you to sit down. No, I'm supposed to wait my turn. Because God want everybody to get his message clearly understood at the same time. So there is no confusion like there is in the body of Christ and church today. Y'all allow people to come in and infiltrate you with a different doctrine that doesn't even line up with the word of God. So, 31 says, for ye may all prophesy one by one, that all may learn and all may be comforted, right? Because if I'm prophesying to you and somebody else prophesying over there and this person prophesying over there, ain't nobody hearing the same prophecy, everybody's not being comforted with the real prophecy of God. You two, bear with me. I just got to put this in here because this is a separate video for you, though. Haha, I got you. Yes, this is a separate teaching for you over there. Okay, this is good for you. All right, so this is all right here in 1 Corinthians 14. I'm going to read verse 31. I've been saying it all along. For ye may all prophesy one by one, that all may learn and all may be comforted, encourages the translation. 32 says, and the spirits of the prophets are subject to the prophets. You get it? Nobody else can judge the prophet. God deals with prophets. He don't deal with apostles. to go say, thus saith the Lord. He doesn't deal with teachers to go say, thus saith the Lord. He doesn't deal with evangelists to go say, thus saith the Lord. He doesn't deal with pastors, preachers, teachers, apostles. He deals with prophets. That's why it says that the spirit of the prophets are subject to the prophets. He had major prophets and minor prophets. This who God sent out to speak his word. And then it says 33, for God is not the author of confusion. I said that earlier, right? Jesus, the Bible says Christ is the author of our finisher and author of our... Christ is the author and finisher of our faith. It says here, God is not the author of confusion, but we know the devil is. And the devil is in church confusing you with who should speak in tongues, when they shouldn't speak in tongues, who should prophesy, who shouldn't prophesy, who should judge the prophets. Don't let them do that to you. This ain't biblical. There's nothing biblical about what they're doing. They're actually doing opposite of what this Bible is saying right here. Look around in the church today. Look in your own church. If it's Pentecostal, Baptist, Roman Catholic, I don't even know if they really even indulge in a lot of this stuff here, but we'll just keep it moving for now. They so far from Christians, Catholics and Romans are not the same. I mean, Catholics and Christians are not the same. Excuse me. Okay, so verse 33 says, I was just saying the Roman Catholics, I had said earlier, I said, I don't think they do what Christians do. I think Catholics and Christians believe totally different stuff, worship totally different, and probably not even worshiping the same Jesus Christ, God, Yahweh, Yeshua, if you ask me. That's just my personal opinion. I've done a lot of research on it and still doing research on it. But I don't even believe, all they do that I know that they do is call themselves saints. That's what the Bible says, you try to be holy, sanctified, and saints. They call themselves saints. That I give them that. The rest of this stuff, I'm not quite sure if they even adhere to it themselves. But they gave it to you, the Christian, to follow. Okay? They didn't want to be slaves either. They didn't want to go by this. They want to be the saints and the high priest. But they don't put themselves through this nonsense you put yourself through as a believer and as a Christian. They say, oh no, that's not me. And it shouldn't be you either. You should ask them, why you? Why we Christian and you Catholic, but you gave us this Christianity? Ask them that. But anyway, back to God's word, because that's really the only thing that matters. You could debunk any lie out there when you come to this word. They can't. Could the Pope ask you right now why you practice Christianity and he practice Catholicism? He probably could, but he won't. And if he do, it ain't gonna be the truth. It's gonna be a lie. And what God say? He hate liars, right? Somebody's out here lying. Hold on, YouTube, hold on. Somebody's out here lying, right? So, hang on. All that confusion you see going on in the church, it ain't God. God is not the author of that confusion you see out there in the church. It is not God. God is not the author of the confusion you see in the church. You see on Facebook with other Christians, on any social media platform, God is not the author of that confusion. You tell them keep that to themselves, okay? Because 33 says, God is not the author of confusion, but of peace, as in all churches of the saints. This says all churches of the saints. Why all churches ain't peaceful? Remember, Jesus says, he went in my house, which was called the temple, not a church. Jesus never went into a church. He walked in temples. Shall be a house of prayer, not a den of thieves. But the church done flipped it. Ain't no prayer going on in the church, and they all thieves and liars. Pretty much all of them. Not all of them. I ain't judging people. I'm calling it as I see it. Let the spirit of the prophets subject to the prophets. I am calling it like I see it out there, y'all. And it go down on here to say, It's gonna go on to say, listen, he's not the confusion, author of confusion. All that confusion you see going on out there, everybody speaking 100 and different and one. Why the church ain't on one accord? This Sunday, we're gonna preach about peace. And the whole church preach about peace, so everybody's on one accord with peace. And this Sunday, we're gonna preach about love. And everybody go to preaching about love to be on one accord. And I'm just sitting here enjoying this. I'm over here in this webcam. When y'all come back on Facebook, I'll be smiling in the camera like, thank you, Lord Jesus. You're allowing people to listen to me because I don't have anything ungodly to tell you. This is all coming from his word. So I'm just excited and rejoicing over here that you guys are talking and listening to me, to thus saith the Lord with me and through me. But listen, God ain't the author of that confusion out there. I was saying when you got disconnected, the Pope, since he's in control of the so-called religion, I think religion is just a whole lot of legions up in church. That's what religion is, if that's what they're going to have. Why don't he make a mandate? Okay, this Sunday we're going to preach on love. This Sunday we're going to preach on peace. And he let everybody do what they want to do within church, and that's confusion too. That's nothing decent and orderly about the church because they're all not on one accord. If you Baptist, then let all Baptist church preach peace this week. If you Pentecostal, let all Pentecostal churches preach love. If you are Holy Spirit or something like that. If you Catholic, preach repentance. Oh, Jesus. Come on here. I'm almost done. Come on. Okay. Okay. Come on in here. 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 All right. Now, this is where it gets a little good with me and God. Jesus Christ, whoever, Holy Spirit, you call him, what you call Yahweh. Verse 34 said, let your women keep silent in the churches, for it is not permitted unto them to speak, but they are commanded to be under obedience, as also saith the law. I'll be like, Lord, did you put this in here when you use women all throughout your word? When you use women to speak all throughout the Bible, up to the book of Corinthians, and now somebody gonna put in here, women keep quiet. One, I think Harriet Tubman and women like that was preaching down the house and was doing some good stuff and was speaking out on behalf of the oppressed slave people. And they're like, shut up, women. You ain't supposed to talk in the church, because men was too busy running around hiding like Adam, because he knew he did wrong and knew a good and evil. And God said, Adam, where art thou? In the book of Genesis, he all naked and afraid, talking about, here I am, Lord, shameful. So women started stepping up, speaking, and delivering God's truth. I just think some old slave master put this up in here for women to shut up. I think some old slave master put this up in here for women to shut up, okay? So now, it says in verse 35, and if they will learn anything, let them ask their husbands at home, for it is a shame for women to speak in the church. Again, me and God, we go toe to toe, and I know that's not godly. That's just some mean spirited person that put this up in here like this to keep women from shutting up, because women have an anointing on their life and can make a damage in the kingdom of darkness just as much as a man can, if not better, more real, more honest, more sincere, more pure. Okay, so then it goes on to say, in verse 36, what came the word of God out from you, or came it unto you only? And then it goes on, if any man think himself to be a prophet or spiritual, let him acknowledge that the things that I wrote unto you be commandments of the Lord. Okay, be commandments are the commandments of the Lord. But if any man be ignorant, let him be ignorant. Wherefore, brethren, convert to prophecy and forbid not to speak with tongues. Let all things be done decently and in order. You get that, YouTube? I lost Facebook over here. All my equipment went dead. Batteries, everything. I'm in Nook, phone. But as I said earlier, we're going to do much better. We're getting the spectrum up in here. We're going to be able to make better videos, have better quality anyway. And go from there. I love your company. Enjoy your fellowship today. And thank you all. God bless you and be at peace. Because we're going to get this thing right. It is right. We just got to walk in the rightness of it, the truth of it. It's right. We just got to put ourselves in that position. Okay, so with that being said, God bless you. Have a great day. YouTube, thanks for everything. You guys, we're going to learn. We're going to walk. We're going to grow. But don't let nobody deceive you, okay? It's not about being deceived. And remember, in the book of Proverbs 6:16-19, six things the Lord doth hate, yea, seven things is an abomination. Read up on that. 1 Corinthians 14. Read the whole chapter. Start from 27, go on down to 40, and you'll figure out what things are supposed to be decent and in order. And allow that to be, you know, distributed around your churches, on your Facebook pages, things like that, so we can start to open up the eyes and the ears of our people still in darkness, of our loved ones still lost, and that's the name of the game, just building kingdoms, building the kingdom of God within the person, so that they have enough exhort, comfort, and courage to go out and build the kingdom in somebody else. That being said, God bless you and have a great day.